Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to the CEC EduSet live lecture. Dear friends, with our ongoing series on gender study, today we would be conducting a 16th lecture in this series, and we would be talking on gender and environment. In the first half, we would be talking on feminist perspective, ecology and method, whereas in the second half, we would be discussing on climate change, ecological degradation and disaster. And for this very discussion, we have once again with us in our studios Dr. Archana Prasad. Dr. Archana Prasad is a Assistant Professor in Department of Sociology, Kamala Nehru College, University of Delhi. So let's welcome Dr. Archana Prasad and let's try to understand more and more on gender and environment. Hello ma'am, welcome to the lecture.
Thank you, Geetika. Welcome to the 16th lecture in the series of gender studies, and today I'm going to talk on gender and environment. It's very relevant to talk about gender and environment today's society because of the two very complex concepts, gender and environment. In the series of lecture, I've already tried to understand, explain the complexities associated with gender and the need to have a gendered understanding of the social institution, political institution, religious institution. And today we see how it is very significant to have a gendered understanding of our ecology, our environment. Well, in the initial stages, we see environment was considered as into the same category of inferiority in which we would put gender. For example, gender and nature was considered to be synonymous. But over the years, with the second wave of feminism and with the coming in of large contribution by both feminists in sociology, in other economics, in development studies, and with the ongoing environment movement, today we have a very important contributions made by different women to both to the conceptualization of the institution as well as the environment itself. So let's begin with the lecture and we'll try to understand what is the complexity in the relation between gender and environment. The objective of the lecture today is to highlight that women's work is linked to environment through subsistence agriculture, domestic work, and works like sowing and weeding. In the course of the lecture, it will be evident that there is a large percentage of women who are involved in agricultural work, and it is their contribution to agriculture which has to be accounted for in terms of having a gendered understanding. The second objective is to explore different approaches to understanding gender and environment relation. That is, there are different ways in which the complex relations between gender and environment has been understood by different branches or different schools of feminist thought. We look into different ways in which it has been problematized. The third objective is to examine the contribution of women as environmentalists. So it's not that it's only a one-way relation, it's a two-way relation. It's not that environment has to contribute to the benefit of gender. It is that women are playing a lead role. Not today, but since the 18th century, in their movement towards protection of the environment. The fourth objective is to understand and analyze the impact of climate change, environmental degradations and disaster. These concepts has become significant today because of the increase in the environmental degradation, the problem of climate change and the occurrence of natural disaster, which impacts both men and women, but to a large extent, because of the social context in which women belong, the impact becomes more for women than for men. And it's also important to understand that women as a category here is not to be understood as a single category. Intersectionality becomes very significant. So poor women, women who don't have resources, or women who are in the rural areas are more affected by the impacts of disaster and degradation than women from, say, urban areas or from the upper class. So we need to keep in mind the intersectionalities works at different levels to have a differential impact on women. Environment has become an important concept today because of the associated social political concern, and also because there are large number of international institutions, international organizations that have taken up the task of improving the environmental degradation and disaster management. And therefore, today, environmental protection is a global political concern. Women from different social positions experience problem differently. And the most important part is, when we try to understand gender, is the exclusion of women from decision making. That is, the women are not a part either on questions of livelihood or in the part of the policy making decision. So and this is to continue with the public-private dichotomy, because decisions are taken outside, that is in the public sphere. Therefore, women are excluded. The paradox is here that those decisions directly impact women, agriculturalists, rural women, women who earn their income through agricultural modes of production, but they are not included as members, or no choice of these women are taken in the decision-making process. And to a large extent, it will be clear through the lecture that environmental disasters and degradation has a negative impact not only in terms of the social economic well-being of the women, but also in terms of women's health. Her reproductive health, her maternal health is subject to disastrous consequences because of the increase in air pollution, the drying up of rivers. It is all an outcome which is impacting women's health. And the health hazard due to the environmental degradation has again today a global challenge to be faced. For example, large number of time we see that when the rivers dry up and there is no water, because the women has to walk for many distance to collect water for their everyday life. So if the nearby river dries up, the women has to walk for miles. So it adds on to the physical labor, it has a negative impact on the health of the women, and it also affects the livelihood of, because it's a time consuming affair. So we need to understand the complexity of the relation between gender and environment. So coming to the most crucial point, which has been an integral part of all the lecture, why gender matters. And here the significance is to understand gender in environmental scenario. According to Sieger, who's contributed to the feminist understanding of environment and development, environmental institutions are gendered. And this is not something which is specific to environment. In the previous lecture, it has been made clear that it is the religious institution, it is the political institutions, it's an educational institution. They are all gendered in the sense that the power relation or the person who are into the decision making process are by and large men, and therefore it becomes a kind of a gender biased institution. Individual behavior is gendered, and that becomes very crucial when we try to see the livelihood of women. For instance, if the woman has to be going to the field as well as to do the domestic chore, so her behavior towards the domestic life as well as her public life would be accordingly shaped. Men and women have different relationship to the environment. In the feminist understanding, in the initial stage, it was considered that the women were more close to nature. But later on, with the post-structuralist feminists, they questioned the close connection between nature and gender, and that the questioning of the dichotomy becomes very crucial in order to make environment more gendered. Fourth, environmental degradation has a different impact on men and women. In the second part of the lecture, I'll look into the impact which is more acute in the case of women in this situation where there is a disaster or environmental degradation. Environmental action and discourse is gendered. What I have already said is in terms of the decision-making process, in terms of the participation of women in larger gendered institution is problematic where they are still a minority. Gender differences are evident in the use and management of natural resources. So, the access of resources again gendered because of the whole understanding of the patriarchal relations, women's access to natural resource is restricted, and therefore there is an unequal relation in the family and the community. Gender differences are evident in the livelihood. Because most of the time the understanding is that women would be doing work which would be within the domestic sphere. So the and would be doing work which would be more easy to do. And therefore the gendered sexual division of labor hampers the way in which the use of resources are done. Gender differences are evident in knowledge of environment, knowledge of a specific resource and environmental problem. This again comes in from the way in which the relation between men and women has been structured, in the sense the access to knowledge, the access to information was only for the men. As a result, the women were denied access to education, they were denied access to decision making body, they are denied participation in public affair. So the knowledge over a period of time, the knowledge becomes limited. As a result, if the knowledge about natural resources, the natural about your environment is limited, your action would actually get impacted. Gender differences are evident in responsibility for managing, owning or stewarding resources. So again, the crucial important is how you use your natural resources. The decision is in the hands of the male members of the community. So that again impacts the way in which the livelihood decisions would be taken. Gender differences are evident in the encounter with environment, in perception of the environment, and also in terms of the nature and severity of environmental problems. So it's not that the environment is a gender neutral institution. At every level we see there is a kind of a reflection of unequal relation between men and women, and that gets reflected in the way people access to livelihood, in the way men and women respond to natural disaster, and the way men and women perceive the environment. For example, before the arrival of the capitalist economy, women would consider environment as close to themselves. They had a relation of nature and nurture, but for men, it was a means of profit, and that is the reason why environment was exploited to increase profit. So the perception is different. Understanding of how gender affects environment can be understood at three levels. At one, we see women's and men's roles and responsibilities. So in the previous lecture, I've already discussed that the roles of dependent on the sexual division of labor. Access and control of resources, knowledge and participation in decision making. Economic, social institution and legal constraint. Legal, for a very long time, women did not have access to right to property. So they had no property, they could not own land. So if you had to become an agriculturalist, you had to be a tenant on a man's land. So that was problematic. Rights are also often linked to land ownership. In many cases, women lose these rights if they are divorced or widowed. And also the whole mindset where women are not considered as the head of the household, the ownership of land generally does not transfer to the women members of the family. The knowledge based on gender roles and responsibility affect the way in which they interact with the environment. Now, after having a conceptual understanding of the relation between gender and environment, it is important to look at some of the feminist contribution in understanding environment. And the most classical feminist who have problematized the way in which we understand environment is the contribution of Esther Bostrup. Esther Bostrup was a Danish economist, contributed to the discourse surrounding gender and development. She brought in the whole concept of the realization that even after decades of development, the development process has actually not benefited women, and it was only after her research and her work that the whole understanding of the relation with women in the development process became to concretize. The next feminist is Carolyn Merchant. Her work, The Death of Nature, Women, Ecology and Scientific Revolution, was published in 1980. She argues that there is a major parallel between degradation and nature of exploitation of women. So the whole idea is that both nature and women were considered as subordinate and inferior, and also that it was the men who had a superior position could exploit nature as well as women according to their whims and fancies. During the Enlightenment period, the value attached to both ecology and women was challenged by these feminists. And they were trying to understand that you have to come out of that understanding of considering women and nature as synonymous, and the whole relation of a hierarchy had to be done away with. So they questioned the assumption of nature is synonymous to women. There are large number of branches of feminist which has contributed to the understanding of environment, like ecofeminism, feminist environmentalism, socialist feminist, feminist post-structuralist, and the feminist political ecology. The main concern of these feminists have been majorly is the question of survival, because a large percentage of women are directly linked to the environment. It is a question of survival of these women. The rights to life and work. So it's not only a question of trying to understand livelihood within the domestic sphere, that women are working as a part of the family and community, but to try to understand it, to put it into the broader framework of right to work. And the right to work not only in itself, but to work in a healthy and safe environment. So the concern is to ensure that wherever they are working, whether it's a domestic mode or whether outside the domestic sphere, it has to be a healthy and safe environment. The responsibility to protect habitat. So it's not only to protection of women's rights, it's also a two-way relation, in the sense that the environment also has to be equally protected by the activities of men and women. The determination to restore the and rehabilitate what has been harmed. So it's also the question that there is large number of disaster and the degradation. So the onus to restore back the environment is not only on men, but it is equally on the women. The most important contribution and or the most initial understanding of the relation between nature and women was done by the ecofeminist, and they've tried to bring out that there is a shared history between nature and women, that is, both are subject to exploitation. And the understanding is that the more the nature is exploited, the inequality or the exploitation of women would further increase. And the whole argument that they make is that women had the close bond, or they are more close to nature, and therefore there is no need to develop a relation of between environment and feminism. Ecofeminism is rooted in the idea that women depend closely on the environmental resources and also care about environment. So what is being stressed in this lecture is not only to look into environment of how it will benefit women or how it is going to ensure livelihood for women, but it's more important to understand how we can contribute for the safeguarding the environment. Women have a close relation to the nature, and therefore they can become better safeguard or protector of environment. And this is evident from a large number of environmentalist movement, not only in India but across the world. Vandana Siva was the feminist who had articulated this approach of ecofeminism. She portrayed women as victim of environmental degradation, linking environmental exploitation to exploitation of women. She emphasized direct involvement of women in the development program because women are more closely related to the environment. The next approach is feminist environmentalist, and this was articulated by Professor Beena Agarwal. So she emphasized on the material aspect of the relation between gender and environment. The feminist environmentalists are more interested in trying to focus on the resources, on the material and the livelihood of men and women, and the ways in which these material resources could be available and could be used to enhance the status of women in society. According to Beena Agarwal, the relationship between environment is caused by different forms of interaction between human beings and their material interest. So there is a material relation in the sense that environment is being used for production, for livelihood, and therefore it is important to emphasize the material relation rather than just emphasizing on the symbolic relation between women and environment. It is the women who have access, who are close to nature, and if given the chance of using it for their livelihood, and they have deal with it in their everyday life. Women's relationship with environment emerges from the social context of dynamic gender relation of a natural affinity. They unpacked women as homogeneous category. So this was the approach of environmental feminist, where they saw that all women across the different gender, class, race and ethnicity could be considered as one synonymous group, and that the relation with the nature was synonymous. The shift of focus from roles to responsibilities. It is not only in terms of trying to understand the relation that you have with the environment, but what is the responsibility of women in society towards the environment. Both these critiques highlighted the property relation and need to look at informal practice and arrangements in property. So property is a material resource, and since women were denied access to property, it is important to bring back the focus on property to enhance the relation between gender and environment. The socialist feminist focused on gender into political economy. So there was a concern of involving women more into the decision-making process to delineate women and men into the economic system. The more they are participating in the decision-making, the chances of taking decisions would be important. Feminist post-structuralist. The feminist post-structuralists are more concerned with the access to knowledge in terms of how knowledge could be used for the benefit of men and women. And that is, in the beginning of the lecture, I said that the access to information and knowledge is restricted. So the concern here is to enhance the access to knowledge and information, which would in way improve the status of women. Then we have feminist political ecology. The feminist political ecology are more concerned about the bringing in what environmentalism and the post-structuralist are saying. That is, you have to combine material as well as knowledge for ever to have a more gendered relations. There are a large number of women who have been involved in the feminist movement from the day, and there we have Russell Carson, whose book Silent Spring started the campaign against the pesticides and chemicals and the disastrous effect on human being. Then we have the Green Belt movement, which was started by Wangari Maathai of African women. And it was because of an approach that there was a whole idea of planting green and increasing greenery all around. In India, for the we have the CEC-UGC movement, was a women-led environmentalist movement, And it was initiated by Amrita Devi 300 years back when she took on the call for protecting the environment and raised, started a campaign for preventing trees from being cut down. Then we have Julia Butterfly Hill, who was successful in the America for bringing up the environmentalist campaign. Similarly, there have been societies and organizations in Japan, China, Thailand, and different women have taken the lead working on the right to environment. So we have already talked about the CIPCO movement, where the women in the in India, they started considering trees as close to their heart, and they stopped people from cutting it by embracing it or hugging it. Then we have the Narmada Bajao Andolan, where the Narmada the Narmada Dam had to be prevented from developmental agenda, and we see Medha Patkar and Arundhati Roy playing a lead role. Then we also have Navdanya, which is a women's organization started by Meera Vandana Shiva. And this is based on the cultivation of organic food and to enhance the women's livelihood skill. There is also the Kenya land takeover in the African, where there was a whole issue towards the giving women the right to land and property. So what is very significant to or try to understand in this is that it is a two-way relation. So we have come a way ahead of trying to move out from the private-public dichotomy and try to understand that the livelihood of women depend on the environment. And it is the responsibility of women to protect the environment from further degradation, from further, because it would directly affect their life and livelihood. So the more the women are given the chance to have access to resources, to participate in decision making and be in the forefront, they would be able to take action for the protection of environment and accordingly improve their livelihood, which would in turn enhance the status of women in society. With this, we come to an end of part one of the lecture. Welcome to part two of the lecture. In this session, I'll be looking into the issues of climate change, environmental degradation and disaster, and try to understand how these environmental processes have an impact on the livelihood, on the well-being, and most significantly on the health of women in the in society. So when we look into the question of gender and climate change, we see that climate change is a global phenomena where there is a change in the kind of climate that has been a part of it, and there's a kind of a global warming because of the emission of large number of natural gases such as carbon dioxide, which is heating up the Earth's atmosphere. And we can see this climate change in terms of the extension of the summer season and the restriction of the winter season. That is, we are having longer summers and less of winter season. So this climate change is not only an ecological problem. It cannot be limited to the understanding only to an environmental issue, but it is a social issue, and in that sense it has ramification on the livelihood of the men and women. It has serious ramification in four dimensions. Food availability, because if the climate is not suitable for the crop cultivation, the availability of food would be reduced. Food accessibility, again they is in terms of the warming up of the global Earth's atmosphere, we see the water bodies are drying up. As a result, the accessibility of food becomes restricted. Food utilization, then utilization in the sense that it would be only available to those who could afford at a higher price. So not only will there be inequality based on gender, but the economic inequality would further get aggravated, and also in terms of food system stability. So one needs to understand the repercussion or the consequences of global warming is extremely high in terms of poor and the rural society. It has been well documented and researched that with the increase of global warming, with climate change, there are larger social consequences of increasing poverty, of increasing feminization of poverty, and in terms of increase in the inequality between men and women from this different class. So what happens is that society was already gendered, there is already a system of subordination and inferiority. With these problems, the gender inequality gets further exaggerated. That is, when there is enough resources, there is limitation in access. So when this resources gets further diminished, the access to them will further become problematic, because it will only be accessible to those who have power or those who are at the higher position. And by the patriarchal function of the society, it would be the men from the upper classes who could have access to these resources. Some of the important gender perspective on climate changes are: 60% of the world's poorest and most vulnerable people are women, who are dependent on natural environment to earn a living and feed their families. So if climate change is going to have a consequence, it is the women who are going to suffer. Existence of gender inequality in access to resources, including credit, extension service, information technology, impacts women. Feminization of poverty, gender division of labor makes access to resources for women difficult. Gender differences in attitude and perceptions of climate change, and these are relevant in developing strategies to address this issue. Since the poor are most vulnerable to the impact of climate change, then women, as disproportionate percentage of women, are particularly vulnerable. So intersectionality becomes important here, and as I have said in my previous lecture, that when these different identity works together, it becomes a question of double marginalization. That is, it is the poor who are more vulnerable, and if it is a poor woman, the risk of vulnerability will increase. And this is what I just said, that if in case there is a diminishing amount of resources, the vulnerability of poor rural women becomes extremely high. Women faces particular challenge giving the primary role of caretaker. So they are not only caretaker of human beings, they are also given the task and responsibility of caring for the environment. So it becomes a kind of a double role which is given on to especially at the time of the problems. Some analysts have argued that gender inequalities and roles also relevant variables in tackling climate change in northern countries as well as in the south. So, what is significant is that it is not only a problem of a particular nation, but it is a global phenomena. But what is also important is to understand that women have taken the challenge, and in spite of restriction, in spite of structural obstacles, they have been able to come up with alternatives, and they have come up with solution to face the problem of climate change. For example, poor nomadic women may have a relatively high adaptive capacity because of their intimate knowledge of their natural environment. So, it is not always that it becomes a question of restriction. It can also be used according to the climate and according to the suitability of the native women. Women are more dependent for their livelihood on natural resources that are threatened by climate changes. So, they face social, economic and political barriers that limit the coping capacity. Women farmers currently account for 45% to 80% of all food production in developing countries, about 2/3 of the female labor force in developing countries, and more than 90% in many African countries are engaged in agricultural work. As I've already said, that there is a high percentage of women who are involved in agricultural work, not only today, but it is something which is carried on from the ancient time. In the context of climate change, traditional food resources become more unpredictable and scarce. So, the food which is a source of livelihood or which is of a high rate of consumption for the people is affected by the process of climate change. So, what is happens is there is a kind of a vicious circle. So, a problem of climate change leads to low productivity. Low productivity would lead to low accessibility, and the low accessibility of food and resources would further marginalize women in the society. Women face loss of income because large number of crops are not having the same amount of production, or it has been degrading. There is a loss of women, and this is again directly related to the status of women, where they are denied right to access to ownership. They only work as a tenant on the lands of others, and therefore if the production goes down, there is a fear of losing the employment and therefore loss of income. So, next we look into the gender issues in disaster. A disaster is an occurrence such as hurricane, tornado. These are the natural disasters which occurs because of environmental problems, and there is a debate on whether these natural disasters are occurring because of the human activity, because human activity is interacting with the nature in such a manner that it is actually creating obstacles in the path of the river, or it is not allowing the nature to work on its own, that natural disasters take place. And they are the number of disasters have increased in the recent year, and it is a reflection of the environmental degradation in our country. It is widely known that it could affect disaster like climate change would affect men and women differently. In the situation of disaster, women are disadvantaged in two ways. One, they sustain direct damage of production losses, house and means of production. Two, there is a loss of income when they have to apply themselves temporarily to unpaid emergency tasks and increased amount of unpaid reproductive work, such as caring for the children when schools are closed. Actually, the whole idea is to see it in terms of direct outcomes and indirect. Direct outcome is if a disaster takes place, both men and women would have to face loss in terms of property, in terms of their livelihood. Well, the second is the indirect consequences, because in most society, in most families, it is the male who is the earning member. So, if there is a death or there is a loss of a male member, the onus of earning and the livelihood goes on to the female who do not have access to the outside world, and her capacity to work independently to earn a livelihood becomes therefore problematic, and there is a problem of being able to take care of the family and take care of the community. There have been instances where floods or on the having huge floods or earthquakes where a large percentage of men lost their life and the entire society was left with only women. In such situations, the gender relations really becomes very complex. There are a large number of data which has been collected for understanding of the impact of disaster on women, and here are some of the figures. 75% of displaced population is of women and children. This is who are displaced due to the disaster. 3 to 5 women die for every man who perishes due to extreme phenomena. 90% of 140,000 victims in Bangladesh in 1991 were women. 56% of the tsunami victims in Indonesia in 2004 were women. Women and children are 4 times more likely to die than men. So again, this is not only something which is a problem of environment per se, but what is important to understand is that the economy, religion, social structure are intertwined. So one reflects the other. If there is a disaster, because of the social structure or the way in which gender relations has been structured in society, the repercussion of these disaster becomes even more acute. The third issue that is significant here is environmental degradation. Environmental degradation implies that there is a decline in the quality of the environment around us, and we know that the quality of the air, the amount of water available in terms of the nature outside is getting affected because of industrialization, because of increase in pollution, because of the number of human beings increasing, and the many political political economists would say that the burden on the earth has increased, and therefore there is a degradation in the environment. Again, when there is an environmental degradation, rural women are disproportionately affected. The differential impact of natural disaster on women and men. With growing environmental instability linked to climate change, it is expected that natural disaster will increase its frequency. So we are looking into the way in which human society is using technology, the way in which human society is trying to control nature. In the coming years, there will be more and more of environmental degradation and disaster, and this will have a consequence on the human mankind. In the last few years, researchers have started to document the differential impact of degradation on men and women. During a natural disaster, 25 women's economic insecurity tends to increase more than men's, given that women often start with fewer resources than men. So keeping in mind that the resources are limited during a disaster or environmental degradation, the resources gets further restricted. Women often face gender-specific barriers when dealing with relief and reconstruction worker. Generally, the whole idea of reconstruction or rehabilitation in situation of environmental disaster is considered to be a responsibility of men. To a large extent, the involvement of women is negligible in these process. So, the outcome is that when men are involved in the reconstruction, rehabilitation, the chances of leaving out or ignoring women could become a problem, and therefore it is important or it is significant to ensure that women are involved in the process of rehabilitation and reconstruction. Impact of disaster and degradation. Deforestation, water scarcity, soil degradation, exposure to agricultural, industrial chemicals and other environmental problems have different impact on men, women, boys and girls. It can lead to more time and energy on task. So, because of the change in the environment, there is a chance of doing more manual work, more involvement of energy, and again because of the gender stereotype of the between feminism and masculinity, the women would have to be left out in the process. Exposure to indoor pollutants. So there is increase in the pollution not only to the rivers and the outside air, because also inside the indoor pollution has increased. Decreased nutrition for families. So environmental degradation affects the quality of food, and that in turn will impact the nutritional intake. And when there is a decline in the nutritional intake of the members of the family, the health of children and women would suffer. Increased reproductive risk. This has again been researched and documented by large number of feminists, that when there is increase in the pollution, where there is increase in the chemicals around, or whether the environment is declining, the reproductive capacity of women gets affected. And there have been researches which says that the infertility rates have increased, the problem associated with maternal mortality and morbidity has increased with the increase in environmental degradation. Many a time it is the responsibility of women and girls in the rural areas to collect fuel, wood and water is the task of the women. So in case where there is a deforestation, or in place where due to the degradation of due to disaster, these resources are unavailable, it increases the burden of the women to get a hold of it for their livelihood. As men and women travel long distance for fuel, wood, fodder and water, they expend large amount of energy. The WHO estimate that energy used to carry one day consumes one third of women's daily calorie intake. So coming back to the important point is that there is a kind of a linkage between one and the other. So and repeating again that there is a decline in the resources, the kind of the quality of the food and crops available is declining. The resources are declining, and because of this decline, the nutritional intake of the members of the family is denying, and there is an increase in the health hazards related to the environmental degradation. Soot from burning biomass fuels such as wood and charcoal or agricultural residues for cooking and heating primarily affects women and children who spend more time indoor than the. So this is a kind of an indoor pollution where in large number of rural area it is use of charcoal for cooking food, and what the gas that is emitting from them has a negative consequences on the women. Women and men are often forced to change their family's dietary practices when soil fertility has been reduced due to overcropping, overgrazing or erosion, or where there is a lack of fuel, food and potable water. So the whole dietary intake is modified. Exposure to agricultural and industrial chemicals and organic pollutant increases women's vulnerability in pregnancy and childbirth, and can lead to child illness and mortality. I have already discussed that there is an increase in child mortality and morbidity because of the environmental ill effects. Pesticides exposure has been linked to stillbirth. So there is an increase in the use of pesticides and chemicals in agriculture, and this not only harms the quality of the food and crops that are grown, but these use of pesticides and chemicals have a negative consequence on the people who are associated with it. So it has a health problem of people who are exposed to these pesticides and chemicals. So coming to the environmental health hazards faced due to environmental degradation. Survival of women and the family is closely linked to the health of land, forest, fishery and natural resources. So there is the connection between the health of the environment and health of the human being. So as long as we maintain a healthy environment, the society around us will remain healthy. The more the quality of the environment is going to degrade, the health of community is going to decline, and more so the health of women and young children. Increased use of pesticides threatens women's health and the health of future generations in all parts of the world. Unsustainable pattern of production continue with women facing serious health risks, especially reproductive health. Modern hazards such as urban air pollution and exposure to industrial chemical and waste are creating a complex kind of illness in the industrial urban area. We are all aware of the increase in the pollution in cities like Delhi, where the air that we inhale is completely of low quality. And also the use of water. We know the underground water level has gone extremely down, and the water that is being used to a large extent, or to according to the WHO estimate, is not healthy. So the more we exploit nature, the more our health is going to be affected. So there are both kind of hazards in the as a result of environmental degradation. We have the traditional hazards like the quality of water and sanitation, the access to problem associated with sanitation, waste disposal, are all traditional problem, and the modern hazards are questions of air pollution, low quality of air, low quality of drinking water, and so on. Gender roles dictate that women become the primary caretaker for those affected by disaster. So it is not only that they are caretaker in the normal time, the responsibility of taking care of those in disaster increases during for the women. And that is that they have to take care of the injured and the sick, as well as the declining status of the environment. Domestic work increases enormously when support systems such as childcare, school, clinic, public transportation and family network are disrupted or destroyed. So in a situation of disaster, there is chances of these public institutions getting demolished, and these are the support system for women in rural areas to do their domestic work. If these facilities are not available, the burden on the women increases. There have been research to show that the domestic violence appears to increase when men's sense of control is diminished. So there is a kind of a psychological understanding, but in the situation of disaster, in situation of conflict, the psychological state mind of men are affected, and their involvement in domestic violence increases. So there is not only the problem of pesticides and declining air quality, there is also the problem of increase in depression, increase in conflict, and increase in violence against women. Nutritional condition determines the capacity to deal with disaster. As women's nutritional capacity is already low, the capacity to deal with disaster becomes complex, and that most of the time the women are incapable of facing or coping up with the disaster, and also situation where there is a disaster, women not only have to take care of themselves, they have to care of the injured and the sick. And this becomes very problematic if they are lactating or they are pregnant women. So, let's look into some of the ideas in which gender and environment health hazards have become problematic. The gender differences increases men's mortality in disaster situation. Many men are exposed to risky situation and even die because they believe that by being the stronger sex, they need to take precaution, and because society expects them to take risky action. So this is bringing us to the first lecture where we talked about gender stereotype, where men are assigned the attributes of bravery, of being strong or being brave. So the mindset is such that they can face disaster, they can face problems more stronger than the women. And these stereotypes need not necessarily work for all men. So the intersectionality becomes significant. Men from poor community, men from rural areas need not be as having the same kind of masculinity as the urban men. So the chances of risk to the life becomes a challenge when you have to negotiate with the gender stereotype ideas of masculinity. Women are not vulnerable because they are naturally weak. So this has been rejected by the feminist of the natural weakness. In the first lecture, I've already talked about the question of nature versus culture and the understanding of women being close to nature and men being close to culture has been questioned and rejected by a large number of feminists. It's not that they are naturally weak or they are inherently weak that the problems of disaster and degradation increases, but it is the social structure which is not in favor of women either to take decision at the time of normal setting, and this structure becomes more hierarchized, more power based when there is a disaster or there is an unnatural situation. The difference in the number of deaths due to natural disaster is directly tied to women's economic and social rights. And so to continue with the whole understanding that it is the economic and social relations that has to be structured and not the naturalness of women to cope with these disasters. Due to economic needs, it is more likely that men will migrate either seasonally or for few years. Again, the whole idea of disaster leads to question of migration, because if there is a diminishing availability of resources, there is a denial of livelihood, the men in these areas in search of livelihood would have to migrate. Now men would migrate leaving behind the women, and women have to take care of again of herself, of the family and the community. So migration and environmental problems are related. The household headed by women are often the poorest. So according to the United Nations Refugee Agency, 80% of the world refugees are women and children. So this statistic shows that the disaster and environmental disaster directly impact women and children. Housewives and young mothers affected and displaced by food have more difficult time finding employment. So what is important in terms to trying to conclude the lecture on gender and environment is that we need to look into the society as an integrated network where one is related to the other, and it is most important to do away with the distinction of private, public, to do away with the distinction of subordinate and superordinate, and that is to try to understand that environment is at an equal relation with human, and it's a relation which will survive only when human beings take care of the environment, and environment will in turn protect human beings. Thank you.
With this note, thank you, ma'am. Thank you so very much. Dear friends, for your feedback, queries, as well as any form of suggestions, we are waiting. Write to us at info.cc@nic.in. We will be meeting again very soon. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you once again.